Here on this disgusting afternoon. I realise that for many of you, this may be your only chance to get in the room with some of these arts commissioners. That's certainly how I feel. My name's Clemency Button-Hill, and I should probably declare an interest from the outset. I do work quite a lot with Mark Bell and Jan Younghusband, but not exclusively, and I'm definitely not here as a BBC representative. We're going to be grilling everyone alike. This session is called Works of Art, and here to talk about the process of making arts programmes, we are delighted to have four very illustrious arts commissioners indeed. Mark Bell is the commissioning editor for arts at the BBC. His direct counterpart is Tabitha Jackson from Channel 4. We have BBC Commissioner for Music and Events, Jan Younghusband, and Katrina Sedgwick, who's head of arts at ABC Television in Australia. Unfortunately, we have lost a couple of members of the panel. James Hunt from Sky Arts and Joe Clinton Davis from ITV unfortunately can't be with us, but I'm sure their presence in the room will be felt. In fact, I think Sky Arts may well be the elephant in the room, so please don't shy away from asking questions about either Sky Arts or ITV just because they don't have representatives here. Now, to kick off this afternoon, we'll be hearing from each of the panellists about the sorts of programmes that they're making at the moment, seeing a little taster of those. They'll also be showing clips of the programmes that they're most proud of at the moment, and we'll be hearing what they're most jealous of from other commissioners' slates, which should be interesting. The purpose of today is to throw out some big questions about arts programming, why it matters, if it matters, the different approaches of public service broadcasters and commercial broadcasters. We want to get to understand how this lot think, what they want, what they're after, and also to understand their sensibilities, their passions, and the strictures that they face, the sorts of challenges that they're dealing with when they pitch to their own channel controllers. And just quickly, I'd love to know, how many of you in the audience are arts filmmakers? Good, quite a lot of you. Well, we really want to know what you think. This is your chance to grill this lot. As we all know, they are hard to pin down. So at any point in the discussion, if you'd like to ask a question, if you want to pick up on something that someone said, please just raise your hand. There are roving mics. If you can wait until you get to a mic, or a mic gets to you, that would be fantastic. But please, we really want this to be an informal conversation, and you're absolutely as fundamental to that dialogue as they are. But there will also be time for a Q&A at the end. Jan, unfortunately, has to nip back to London, so she will be leaving us at 4, but we do have until 4:30 if we need it for everyone else. So, let's get things underway. We're going to start with Mark. You're going to tell us a bit about what you're up to.
Well, you know, I commission a range of stuff across BBC 4, BBC 1 and BBC 2. Clearly, different purposes for each. There's Imagine and The Culture Show both do sort of topical coverage. Single docs, what have we had this week? On BBC 4, we've had a couple of films about London, one about Turner with Matt Collings talking about the Thames, and last night a little film about London's bridges with Dan Cruikshank. One was made by Turn, last night's one was made by Turn in Scotland, and Telescope in Wales made the Turner film. We've got a film about the Anish Kapoor's Orbit Sculpture, which is a culture special this weekend. And a one-off about the Royal Academy Summer Exhibition as well. So, you know, there's quite a lot of coverage, but also we make, you know, documentaries that, you know, add context and explain things. So, you know, it's everything from, you know, Turner to Bridges to wacky towers in East London.
Should we see a little something?
Yeah, I've actually just chosen a little clip from a culture showreel. I've not got anything as fancy as a proper showreel, unlike Tabitha, my counterpart here, but there's a little clip of Jeremy Deller from a special we did when his Haywood show opened, talking about what got him started.
They had a show in London, so actually got a gallery. I thought I'm going to go there, and I'm going to try and meet him, get my history open. And so I turned up at the opening quite early, dressed almost as a schoolboy. And he arrived, and he sat behind a big table, and everyone sat right to the table. He got a pen out, he just started signing his stuff. And then afterwards, I was standing around, and one of these guys who was with him in his entourage came up to me, started chatting to me, saying, "Oh, you should come see us, come over to our hotel." And I thought, is this dodgy or not? I can't work it out. But I'm going to do this. So we're staying at the Ritz. I took a friend with me, my mate Chris, I just thought I needed a bit of backup here. I don't know what I'm doing myself in for with this situation. And we got to the Ritz, and we stood outside the door, and you're thinking, what is on the other side of that door? What are we letting ourselves in for? And I think it appeals because we know what to do, so we're not trying. The door opened, and there's Warhol with like four or five other guys just sitting around watching the Benny Hill show with sound on and listening to some music. Chris, that's something.
It's a good out. You sort of get the idea. What I wanted to show there is that, you know, culture show is mostly sort of arts journalism, fairly topical, but, you know, it doesn't mean that you can't be fairly creative with the treatment of things. And that was a, you know, quite close collaboration with Jeremy, you know, who's quite involved in making the film. A young director called Jack Cocker actually made the film. But I just thought it goes to show that it's about the storytelling, but it's also trying to get to the sort of aesthetic heart of things as well, to some extent. So,
Tabitha.
I love that clip as well, Mark. I think it's really exciting. So I just wanted to flag this up. A BBC producer produced a session. There are two BBC people on the panel, and a BBC presenter, although you're not, you're clearly independent, claiming, is moderating. I just put that out there, and to explain why I'm slightly defensive.
It's not our fault that Sky Arts and ITV absconded from Sheffield. I would like to put that out there.
No, it's all good.
But point taken.
We're all on the same side. So I'm Tabitha. I commission arts for Channel 4, and I keep waffling on about what I hope the arts can be on Channel 4, which is the creative expression of us now. And by that, I mean that I think one of the most exciting ways to work with art and artists is to try and understand ourselves. So in a way, that's what I'm going for. And rather than, say, making films about artists, I'd rather try and work with artists to make films about us. So I also waffle on about how I want television to feel like an art form in itself. It doesn't just need to be a window onto other people's art forms. The television screen can be a canvas. I've been doing this waffling for quite a long time, so instead of doing it again, I have a tape, which, if you'll indulge me, is about 5 minutes long, but it just shows what I've been up to with you guys last year, and is the stuff that we've done since I was here last time. So maybe we can have a look at clip one.
Across such an abyss of time.
Of course, all in jest. I think what I meant by that was that I think what Channel 4 should be doing, because we are all on the same side actually on this panel, but we do things in different ways. And I think what Channel 4 should be doing is to try and break out arts television out of the sense that it is middle class, middle aged, white, that there should be another flavour in there. And I think we're all trying to do the same thing, but Channel 4, I think, has a particular responsibility to do that, has the youngest audience.
What is that thing, Tabitha, just to jump in there? You say you're trying to do the same thing. What is that thing?
Diversity, to make arts feel contemporary and relevant and representative of the community that we live in. But I think that the challenge of trying to do that and even with the quality of things on that tape is that we still have headlines. Just last month, Lord Bragg of Sky Arts said Channel 4, the failing
Lord
on arts,
Bragg of Sky Arts.
Irrelevant. So one can easily become invisible. And so I think that's a big challenge of trying to do stuff that feels new and different, but not completely losing an audience.
Fair point. Jan.
So, I commission music programmes across the BBC. I'm slightly different to other commissioners because music's managed out of radio. So I also work in radio, although I don't commission radio. And what we like to feel is when we're doing our best in music at the BBC, that the whole thing is beautifully joined up in the most marvellous immersive experience. So, for instance, we just had a series, Punk Britannia, which was a three-part series on BBC Four, with other single programmes going around it and partnering with Six Music, who did a whole stack of programmes around it. And the whole thing was announced together, and the idea was that over those 3 weeks that you could have an immersive experience through across radio and television. The BBC is particular because obviously, you know, the audience is very important to the BBC, not least because they're actually paying for the programmes we make. And so getting that right for them is really important. The BBC audience tends to like pretty sort of straightforward, very intelligent programmes about music, which show them the past and kind of reevaluate the past. So you see in our output a lot of programmes that use the archive. The BBC has a fantastic archive, but also our audience likes to look back and likes to have the past reinterpreted. Another important part for us is performance. We do an enormous amount of live performance in our festival coverage. We also put on big live events. Next weekend, if any of you are in London, it is the Radio 1 Hackney 2012 weekend on the football pitches at Hackney Marshes, which is us bringing to the young people of Hackney free, 100,000 people will come free, to hear every single one of the great artists you can think of, Jay-Z, Rihanna, Ed Sheeran, you know, the lineup is extraordinary across six stages. And that is put on by radio. The event is put on by radio, and it's filmed for BBC Three.
So, Jan, just to jump in there, would you refute Tabitha's idea that somehow Channel 4 represents the cooler side, the younger side of the arts when you're putting on something like that?
Well, I think the audiences are all very different, and I think it's really important to understand the audience. That we are in some ways doing the same thing, but we're also speaking to a very different audience. And having worked in both places at Channel 4 and now at the BBC, it's very important in both broadcasters to get the tone exactly right for the audience and to know the audience that you're speaking to.
Can we have a look at something?
Yes. Oh, yes. So I was going to show you a clip. The clip is from a series called Brits Go West. It is just a little clip about... It was a series about how British rock and roll hit America and what happened when we went out there to show them how to do it, apparently.
America, the promised land for British youth in the 60s. America's the Holy Grail for music. For us, it wasn't souvenir. From 1964 onwards, a group of British pioneers would get in their covered wagons and go west.
Such a thrill to actually go to play in America and do a little bit of research, go to new stuff, and then turn out it was just like heaven.
The British invasion would export a new brand of youth to the States. The Beatles, do you know? America in the 60s.
Yes, the other thing that shows, I think, also is that the BBC has a fantastic relationship with the musicians themselves, because they're coming in and out every day to be on our live, in our live music and on radio. And so one of the unique things we have is access to, as you can see from just that clip alone, you know, some very big artists who come and appear and talk on, you know, throughout all our documentaries. So that's a particular, you know, putting the practitioners on screen is a particular thing that we try to do to bring them to the audience.
Katrina, as the sole representative of the international arena on today's panel, we'd love to hear from you.
Yeah, well, I'm also very new to this world. This is week 9 of being head of arts at the ABC. And in fact, it's a new position. The previous role was conjoined with arts and entertainment. And there was a bit of controversy last year where the ABC decided to cut its last arts magazine program, which was not watched by many people, but there was a lot of anxiety when it was removed from the schedule. And those funds that had been spent on it were going into other kind of programming. And so the ABC decided to really kind of focus on the arts, and we're going through a whole kind of process of reflection at the moment. Part of that was creating this sole head of arts position. Head of arts in the ABC commissions work across ABC 1, ABC 2, is involved in trying to get arts programming onto ABC 3, which is the kids' channel focused on the kind of 5 to 12 year age group. We also commission online projects, and we're able to create online work that simply exists in that kind of space. So I have got a clip of what the ABC has been up to over the last year or two, which I can't claim ownership of, but I'm very proud to present to you. So if we can just have a look at that. It's about 5 minutes.
This is an incredible location. This is icebergs and hack ice, the size you can see out from the right, the one spread out in every direction.
3,000 plus years, this rock art hasn't lost any of its power to the floor. I've always been fascinated by his early paintings. For me, they are like encrypted title deeds for country. Amazing. It's on par with anything you'll see in any gallery around the world.
Getting out to a point where I can't see the land anymore, a 360 degrees perfect horizon point, you actually lose some kind of sense of self.
I can't last well. I thought this was howling good.
I'm afraid of to the public and say, look, this is what's helping me now.
So you can see it's fairly diverse what we do, and we've got a couple of regular art slots, and then we one of which is a half hour, the other one which is a Sunday afternoon where we can screen feature length or 1 hour, and then we can do prime time series, be they half hours or 1 hour series. So it's very varied, and then as I say, the online space. So.
Before we move on to kind of pit programmes against each other and find out what everyone else is really jealous that the other people made, has anyone got any questions thus far? Nope. Okay, we're going to move on then.
There is one.
Sorry, I can't see.
Katrina, given most of the people in this room will be probably European, to what extent is it important that your documentaries have an Australian angle on it or not?
If we're doing a co-production, it's got to be very overtly there. But in terms of the kind of acquisitions we have, they don't have to have an Australian angle. We populate our Sunday art slot with a fair bit of international acquisition. I mean, obviously we tend to go for artists who have some kind of presence in Australia, but we're looking at a new strategy at the moment to work more cross-divisionally. As Jan was talking about, one of the great things about the ABC is that there's a lot of radio and online space. There's also a big innovation and multi-platform department. So we're looking to collaborate more closely interdivisionally, as well as, and part of that will be working with our external partners. So, for example, if we're working with, say, the Adelaide Festival of Arts, and they have a particular artist who is yet to be discovered by Australian audiences, say a really interesting theatre company from Georgia, and there is a really wonderful documentary that we hear about. In that case, it might even be a subtitled documentary. We could acquire that and present that as part of our engagement with that particular festival. So a lot of it is a lot of our international acquisitions. We hope in the future will be about context of what's happening right now in Australia.
Right, let's hear from our four commissioners about the works of or the programmes they're most proud of over the last few months. Mark.
I've got a little clip of a Lucian Freud film that we made some time ago now. It was when the show at the National Portrait Gallery opened. But I mean, I'm actually quite proud of quite a lot of what we do, and so I actually really like the Turner film, the Turner's Thames, that was on a couple of days ago. I'm very excited about a collaboration we're doing with the RSC about, which is a performance of Julius Caesar set in modern Africa. It's the Greg Doran thing that's just opened now, and we're doing a sort of filmed version of it through Illuminations. John Wyver's making it. But I'll just show you a little clip of the Lucian Freud film, which Randall Wright made for Dennis Blakeway, Blakeway Productions.
He was acclaimed only in the last quarter of his life. He was famous for mercilessly explicit paintings. Notorious for sex with young women in old age and for a surprising number of children, some like to say as many as 40. In reality, you are 14. Despite his late uninvited exposure, for most of his life, Lucian Freud was almost invisible and always elusive. Lucian's idea of a relationship was to be in love, but to remain in charge. Kitty had to do what she was told.
She had a beautiful life with him. She was described to me this kitchen scene that she called up something that she thought she liked. And then he sat at the table, waiting, and then she put his down in front of him, and then she had to go and sit with her face to the wall in the corner while he ate it up.
Lucian felt free to do anything he liked.
Well, it's now he was looking at something with me. Probably that's why he didn't ask him, Once he got figure something, get started. And the way he used to be able to get away from Kitty was to say, I'm working on a night picture with Charlie, and wait, we'll do an hour, painting, and then I'd get a 3-way to go down the rest.
Why does this exemplify what the BBC does best when it comes to arts programmes?
Well, I think there's quite a lot. It was exciting to be given the opportunity to make that film. It took a while to secure the access, but when it came with, really quite, as I think that clip shows, quite a remarkable degree of freedom in the way we tell the story, and that's why, I thought it was really very revealing for somebody who didn't know Freud's work well. You'd still get quite a lot of sense of, what Soho was like in the 50s, what this extraordinary painter was like. So social context, historical context, and a real sense of him and what drove him and his particular process, which I think rolled together into a rather really nicely finished bit of filmmaking, I suppose. So, that's why I'm proud of it.
How important is that social and historical context for the BBC in particular? I mean, Jan was talking about the types of audience that you're aiming for and how they like to be steeped in the past.
Well, Freud, died last year, so it is the past, but, and of course he was working through, most of the second half of the 20th century, so it is about the past, but it's also about now to some extent. But I do think that it's important to give a sense of the time in which, if you're making a documentary that's retrospective like that, that's looking back, I think it's important to give a sense of the context. I think it helps you understand why you should care about this, this artist. I think context is important, and it can be historical, it can be slightly broader than that as well.
And does that get reflected in audience figures? Or do you find that your audiences prefer a little bit of history with their art?
Well, yeah, actually. You know, if you blend history and arts, you tend to get slightly bigger numbers in the ratings. But, you know, I think there are other ways of telling stories too. I mean, I suppose some of the most successful arts programmes I've been responsible for, I've commissioned, have been, you know, we did this series called Fake or Fortune, which is a, you know, it's a sort of, it comes out of the Antiques Roadshow stable, but it's a hour-long documentary about a single painting, whether or not it's genuine, looking at the provenance, following the kind of paper trail back and the forensic sort of trail too, and sort of trying to find out, and in doing that, you find out quite a lot about the artist in question, technique, and also the kind of, it's a storytelling process of the story of a painting after it was painted, starting with now and going back as far as closely as you can to when it was painted. So I think there are ways of telling stories, illuminating history, that aren't just kind of straight chronology, I suppose.
Tabitha, presumably you take an opposing position. I mean, as we saw earlier, as you proclaimed in that film, living artists, not dead ones. What are you most proud of?
Yeah, and I mean, it's worth saying that I saw the Elusive Forge film and absolutely loved it as a viewer, and it's on my list of things I'm envious of. But as a commissioner for Channel 4, I somewhat perversely, suicidally in career terms, said when I started, I don't want to do arts biographies and profiles, and I don't want to do art history, and I don't want to do arts heritage, because other broadcasters do them incredibly well, and because I think we should be trying to unpick a bit more our lived experience. Who are we? What are our preoccupations? But it is unfortunate because they are the three areas that rate in arts terms. In trying to capture this lived experience, the piece that I love, in fact, if I may, there's a clip two, which is the little adverts, the trails. I think one of the things that I'm proud of is the other people I work with, and for creative team, we talked about how we wanted to try and just market the arts on Channel 4 slightly differently, and that comes down to trying to get as many trails as we can, but also the quality of the trails, so that they too can feel like little bits of art and kind of stop you on your tracks. So there's about 60 seconds of trails. Is that all right, Steve? So it's just a sense of trying to get a bit more energy out there and colour and freshness from, you know, the marketing, the way we talk about things, the way we trail things. Trails are incredibly important, and that the elephant in the room, as you called it, Clemency, that what Sky and Sky Arts are brilliant at is when they have something that they're proud of, they will shout about it to the rooftop so everybody knows they're doing it. Their audiences don't compare with ours, but everyone knows it's around, and I think we can learn lessons from that. Now, the thing I'm most proud of, well, it's not fair to say I'm most proud of, but I've just loved working with these people so much. This is Seneca Productions and Grayson Perry, and it's a series that's on at the moment about taste and class in Britain. And Grayson and Neil Crombie, the director, and I were chatting about how from the arts standpoint, we can talk about who we are and self-expression. Obviously, that comes down to taste. Then we began to talk about taste, and it was almost impossible to disentangle it from class still. And so the idea was born that Grayson would go and just explore. He wants to explore the texture of contemporary life in the same way that I do through programming, so it's brilliant. And he is a kind of Hogarthian figure. Well, he'll take these little details and try and not judge them and not say which is nicest or which is best, but ask why. Why are you making these choices? So it's a three-part series, and I'll just show you the pre-title, which isn't representative of the style of the piece, but gives you a sense of what he's up to. If we could run that clip.
For the past year, this man has been watching what you do. He's been travelling around Britain to the events and social rituals where you reveal the most about yourselves.
Tell me about your loo. Come show me your loo. I'm interested.
He's been looking around your houses, inspecting your possessions, your decor, and your cars. He's been watching what you wear, and even dressing up like you do, because he believes that gives an insight into who you think you are.
It really does look good.
His name is Grayson Perry. He's one of Britain's leading artists, a winner of the Turner Prize.
It's about time that transvestite positive on the Turner Prize.
His art explores the details of modern life and the truths those details reveal about ourselves. And that's why he's decided to tackle the subject of British taste.
Taste has always fascinated me. I look at the world, I see people, how they dress, how they have their clothes, how they do their houses, and I wonder what is behind their choices.
In this series, Grayson Perry goes on safari through the taste tribes of Britain. Not just to observe your taste, but to tell you in his biggest artwork yet what he thinks it means. He's making six huge panoramic tapestries. His personal interpretation of the taste of 21st century Britain.
Tapestries, they were made for the Lord of the Manor, and they would depict great mythical battles of the, you know, Hannibal crossing the Alps, or some fantastic nation-changing event. And I'm using that same concept to depict whether people shop at IKEA or whether they go to Waitrose.
So, that's not a series about an artist, that's a series about us, but working with an artist. And he sees things in a way that that no one else does. I think he's absolutely remarkable to work with. But one of the high spots of that process, not just these enormous six enormous tapestries, loosely based on a rake's progress that Grayson's created and are hanging, they're called The Vanity of Small Differences, this great exhibition. It was this. This is the high spot of my career. The Sun. The first article they wrote was "A Bloke in a Dress Almost Pulls Blokes in Sunderland." That was the first one. Then they rang up and asked whether they could do a spread on Grayson. So we had a double-page spread in The Sun, which is the tapestries. That's contemporary art, details from Hogarth's or Rake's Progress, and a description of what Grayson's doing. Which is brilliant, my favourite detail, because it is The Sun. It says, as with Hogarth, each image features a small dog. Can you spot it? So, but I love it, and that is in trying to reach a slightly different audience to the ones that you might expect. So we're not trying to just reach an arts audience, we're trying to reach an audience. Then the double page spread in The Sun, brilliant.
And how did it rate? Or how is it rating? Still going on.
It rates as a normal arts programme rate, so about, the first episode consolidated at about 750,000 people, which is fine, but I have to say I'm disappointed because I think it's brilliant and it's not intimidating, hasn't got its head up its arse, if you know what I mean, and there's no reason why more people couldn't have come to that. So it's this constant challenge of how do you make the arts breakthrough. I think they still feel kind of intimidating, not for me, not about my life. So I don't know.
That is the big question. Jan, I mean, you often work with classical music, and that is certainly a vexing spectre that looms over us all.
Yes, well, getting classical music across is actually in some ways very similar to doing arts. And incidentally, I love Grayson's series, and if you haven't seen it, you must watch it. It's really, really great. So the one thing about the BBC is that we do a lot of volume. So like we have something like 300 hours of new music programmes a year. You know, they're like coming in like planes into Heathrow every week. You know, there are like five different ones on just over this weekend. So a very important part of what we do is we are bound to deliver to the British public the things they love from the arts institutions and music institutions that, like Covent Garden, who make beautiful things that we have a responsibility to take to the British public. And in some cases, the rest of the world, actually. What I want to talk about was, the thing I'm most proud about was, you know, we have a very long-term relationship with the Royal Opera House. And Tony Hall came to me and he said, what can we do with the Royal Opera House? Because we were putting, you know, operas on telly and less people were watching them. And, of course, the great issue for opera is that, you know, it has an older audience, but they want to have a younger audience. And I don't know if any of you remember a series called The House, which kind of was made about 10 years ago and brought Covent Garden to its knees, practically. And since then, they haven't allowed cameras backstage at all. Anyway, they said, could we speak to a broader audience? And that's what they'd like to do. So we came up with the idea of using a popular format. And this is where I think television's craft is very important, and we don't talk about our craft enough. So television is quite divisive, isn't it? So we thought, OK, we'll use a popular format to speak to the broader audience, but how does the BBC do that without the neighing chorus saying that we're dumbing down and we've lost our brains? Anyway, the way we approached it, we thought, well, we'd made the BBC, before my time, there made a series called Maestro about how to conduct an orchestra. So we thought, OK, obvious, we know that works, so we'll try Maestro at the Opera. And I suppose my proudest moment really was when the Royal Opera House agreed to have the cameras backstage for the first time in 10 years and to sort of expose what they do. And I've got a little clip, it's just the front of it. But the idea behind it really was to use the popular format of a competition to show you something which something about, you know, how conducting is done and what this man who's waving his arms around is really doing at the opera, which is very different to just conducting an orchestra. And if you try to tell that in any other way, it might be very dry and nobody would watch it. So what happened in the end was that we managed to do it. We managed to persuade some very nice celebrities to come and do it. They were all people who liked music or had an ambition to do it, so it was genuine in that way. And then the most unlikely person won it. And on the night, it was really, really spectacular. And then, although we got a bit told off by the press, you know, it's like, oh, look, BBC lost their brains, and the Royal Opera House got told off a bit. Actually, in truth, the audience completely loved it. And the audience went from 7-year-olds to 70-year-olds. And they all said, gosh, I didn't think I liked opera, but now I want to go. And we looked at the figures. It reached 4 million people. And it had one of the highest audience appreciations of any programme we've ever made. And what, you know, what was incredible about it was that 55% of that audience had never really experienced opera. And after watching that programme, they went and experienced it some more. So I think that's the wonderful thing of television, that you can use the craft of television to do something incredibly important for the broader world of the arts, because I think if we do our job well, it's not just sitting at home on your couch watching it, it's the fact that you can watch Grayson Perry or you can watch these lovely films and then you'll actually think, you know what, I'm going to go to the Tate. And that's, I think, a very important part of what we do. So here's a little clip of, I think it's just the front of the programme.
Ultimate art form. It's the most powerful drama in the world, and the conductor is in charge of everything. Four novices are competing for the ultimate honor, to conduct an opera performance in front of a discerning audience.
I can't remember if Shishma was actually involved in this piece.
I was shaking so much I couldn't do the trance.
I felt violently ill.
Last time, our students attempted famous arias, conducting soloists and the orchestra of the Royal Opera House. Mathematician Marcus kept strictly to time.
I was really, really impressed, Marcus.
While Josie and Craig were praised for conveying their passion.
Fabulous!
But it was time to put down the baton for DJ Trevor Nelson.
You were so seduced by the music that you lost the orchestra then.
The conductor who's been appointed to go further is Josie.
Three students are left, but there can only be one winner. There can only be one maestro at the opera.
So, it's obviously a very familiar format, but I think the way, you know, it was a deliberate decision to use it to speak to the broader audience, and actually it was a very, very intelligent series, and also very entertaining. So I was very proud of it because it seemed to me to be the perfect mix of both things.
Jan, just really quickly, because I know you've got to run off soon, just to go back to your point about being told off by the press, it is nearly 4 o'clock, just about. Oh, but we'll just really quickly, this question of having to use a format like that, of the fact that the press would tell you off if you did use a format like that, presumably for dumbing down, but if you used a format that wasn't like that, and if you didn't have access to a wider audience, they would tell you off for being too elitist. How do you reconcile that and the fact that the BBC are forever being bashed in that way?
Well, I think it's interesting because I think sometimes with Channel 4, you kind of expect Channel 4 to be cheeky and naughty. The BBC has to be very careful about its tone in that. And I think it's probably to do with the nature of our financing. But so quite often we get told off about things by people and they haven't even seen them. But there's a sort of expectation that that we have a sort of moral obligation to do things a certain way. And that can make it quite tough to take the kind of risks that you would like to take. Because the moment they hear that you're sort of pushing the edges in the way that Channel 4 will sort of, you know, I may say, can swing from the chandelier because they get, you know, like, right, how can we just do it? You know, if you take that approach at the BBC, you can get in terrible trouble because people assume that you've just lost the plot. So it's how we can, you know, break the edges down a bit, which is the most difficult thing.
And really quickly, because I know you've got to run, which programme are you most jealous of that someone else has made?
Oh, well, it was just this film, My Architect, which I know it's a programme from way back, but when I saw that film, I actually saw it in the cinema, and then I wasn't at the BBC at the time, but the BBC showed it. But it was an amazing... I thought to myself, would this have been commissioned? Would I have commissioned this? You know, this filmmaker had come and said, I've never made a film, or a film about my father I never knew, and he's an architect that I'd probably maybe never heard of, and it was a story based from America, not from here, and so on and so forth. And so it made me think, I thought it was a beautiful film about the power of our built environment and how important it is. So it was a really incredible film. But the other thing was that it made me think that maybe sometimes commissioning, we're too prescriptive. And my biggest anxiety really is that we're not too prescriptive and we sit on platforms saying we want this and we want that and like this and like that. And actually the really beautiful things aren't like any of that. They're something else. And I think it's just really important that I hope that we can all recognise those things when they come through.
Go and get your train. Thank you so much for joining us. Katrina, let's hear from you about the thing
you want.
You're
Adam
missed.
Barker to step up?
Yeah, someone could step up. You know, we better have another BBC person on the panel, because otherwise, you know.
Oh, we can't have another one.
We can't let them.
I'm leaving so Tabitha doesn't feel that.
Another one down.
Thank you, Katrina.
Let's hear from you about what you are most proud of.
I'm going to talk about a couple of things. The first one is a film that, in order to make a documentary, a kind of substantial observational documentary to trigger financing through Screen Australia, which is our national funding body, you have to have a broadcaster attached. And it's getting increasingly difficult to get observational documentaries funded. Mrs. Kerry's Concert was a project that the ABC came on very, very early and committed to as a one-hour observational documentary. It's by Bob Connolly and Sophie Raymond. Bob Connolly is one of the most kind of highly respected documentary makers in Australia. He's wonderful. What happened with this film was quite unusual. My previous job was working with the Adelaide Film Festival and we had an investment fund, and he approached us and said, look, I think I think we've got more than an hour. We'd be interested in doing a feature. And so we put a bit of money in that as well, which is why I feel I can talk about it, because I was involved in the making of it. And so it became a feature-length documentary, and the ABC then turned around and said, we love it. It was screened at the Adelaide Film Festival on opening night. It blew everybody away. What was very exciting is we had a live event with it. You'll see in the clip. Well, maybe we'll play the clip quickly and then we'll talk about it. This is the trailer.
I have a little concert that's coming. You with me? But we're all on different wavelengths.
It's gone on for a couple of years. And there's lots of references to being wasted, drinking, vomiting, whatever. I'm not saying anybody's involved in all of that. But actually, this kind of things they're doing, it's really atmosphere.
You know how my Jean Crown turned out there, trap up in? Don't just know what she's like, because she has an instrument in her hand. Of course.
So it's, you know, it's a film that's not particularly kind of sexy. I mean, it's about a you know, all girls music school.
Hey, classical music can be sexy.
But, you know, it's about a music school. It's teenage girls going through a music school, doing a school concert, essentially. But it became this kind of much bigger thing, and it was, you know, it's about the role of teaching and the power of music and how you nurture talent at a key point in a child's life, in a girl's life, where things become very precarious in adolescence, and you can easily kind of miss your moment to kind of really live, you know, fulfil your promise. And I suppose that's what it's about, aside from the kind of wonderful music in and of itself. And so it premiered at the Adelaide Film Festival. It could never have had the kind of outing that it did opening our festival. It was our opening night film without the ABC's support. It got a rapturous response, and out of that it got a theatrical release in Australia. It went on to become the fourth highest Australian documentary ever in box office terms, which is just incredible. It went from being kind of probably fairly buried in the ABC schedule to playing at 8:30 on a Sunday night, which is the prime time slot, and it rated really well. So it was a real kind of success story, and I think really underlines the importance of the broadcaster in enabling beautifully crafted observational documentary in any form, specifically in this case arts, and a really kind of great story. The Chinese girl, Emily, who you see in it, she's just blossomed. She's here in London, or in the UK, on scholarship, studying at the London Academy of Music, and people from the Berlin Philharmonic were touring in Australia, and they flew back on Qantas and saw the film and absolutely loved it, thought it was the best kind of music education film they've ever done. So they're flying her over in February. She's going to do a solo with the Berlin Philharmonic before they screen the film as part of the Berlin Film Festival the next day. So, you know, it keeps on keeping on, and I think it's a really important thing that broadcasters step into that territory. The other thing I just wanted to talk about is something that, again, in my previous guise, but with the ABC, we set up an interesting project, a lab called The Hive. This lab was about trying to, I think some of the areas that you're talking about, trying to invite artists to come into the space of the screen. So we invited leading choreographers, theatre directors, writers, visual artists, installation makers to come in. There was about 12 of them working with 10 very interesting kind of open-minded filmmakers and television makers. And the idea was, it was called The Hive. It was about cross-pollination. It was about getting artists to think about that as a creative space and have conversations with filmmakers for potential collaboration. But in the reverse, it was always also about trying to get the filmmakers to think about creative development and the making of new work for the screen in different ways in terms of creative process. So film and television tend to be usually quite a linear development process, and we're wanting artists, filmmakers to think more laterally about a kind of flatter, more ensemble kind of driven process. So out of that, we established a fund. We have $200,000 from ABC, from the Adelaide Film Festival, and for the Australia Council of Arts, and we commissioned three programs which will screen on the ABC next year after their premiere at the Adelaide Film Festival. And that's a feature-length musical by one of Australia's more avant-garde leading theatre directors. We're doing a one-hour, reasonably conventional observational documentary, but it's by one of the most interesting visual artists that we have in the country at the moment, Lynette Walworth. And we've also commissioned a half-hour docudrama, which is going to be a collaboration between a filmmaker and a leading choreographer. So we're doing that again next year, and I think it's a really exciting space that the ABC is moving into there.
Anything you've seen on BBC or Channel 4 that you're jealous of?
Yes, I'm extremely jealous of The Space, which is the new initiative between the BBC and the Arts Council. In my very short time at the ABC, I've realised that the online space is extremely important for us because a lot of the arts programming is not screening at times that are necessarily attractive to a kind of energised arts audience. We're very interested in the contemporary space in terms of trying to capture what's happening right now in terms of creative practice in Australia. But that kind of work doesn't really sit in one of our main slots, being Sunday afternoon between 3 and 5pm. So we're moving into that online space, and I'm very, very envious of what's happened between the BBC and the Arts Council. It's running from May until October, aligning with the Cultural Olympiad, and 53 works have been commissioned. I think the budget's about £5 million. It's incredible. And it's incredibly diverse. So it's a space where you have, for example, a whole of the Shakespeare stuff that's being done for the Olympiad is being kind of streamed. There's also, so I suppose the kind of usual arts programming as you would expect appears in that space. But alongside that, it really is very much a space for experimentation. So I think, is it Will Self who's creating a kind of a new writing process that's a collaborative writing process with his audience through the space?
The best way of... there is Will Self on there. There's lots and lots of experimental stuff. There's David Shrigley's done animations. There's lots of BFI archive. There's lots of streamed performance from the Globe. And, you know, there's John Peel's record collection. You do a letter a week. So I think this week's Gallon Drunk because we got to G. And so it is... it's an interactive digital arts platform made mostly by quite small arts. Some of them, arts institutions mostly have bid for cash from the Arts Council to make stuff. I mean, it's quite hard to describe it. I log onto the space and you'll see it because it's quite varied and there's a real range of stuff there, stream stuff. So there are moments there, but there's also quite a lot there just to go and explore. And it is interesting. I mean, I think what Tabitha's been saying about what makes Channel 4 different from the BBC, I think there's truth in that, and it's quite hard for us to do something that's as experimental on our mainstream channels. And so the space is absolutely trying to get to to use the BBC's kind of skilled resource, I suppose you might call it. You know, we're really offering technical support and, some kind of filmmaking guidance to a lot of institutions and young filmmakers and so forth who haven't really had the chance to make stuff. So it's been a very interesting experiment.
But is it an experiment or a space to which people can pitch if they have ideas?
I mean, well, it's an experimental space running for the period of time that... just been described up to
and
sort of autumn. Well, you know, yeah, technically, we don't know what will happen next, but it's up to the Arts Council, and, you know, there's quite a lot of questions still there, but you know...
Sorry to interrupt you, Mark, because I do think the space is absolutely fascinating, but it raises really big questions. I think I'm really looking forward to what they call the analytics coming back in. So, you know, arts organisations working with producers to get their own content, to be their own broadcasters in a way. So I think the really interesting question is, how does that work? Who comes to it? How long do they stay? How does that work when it comes to connected television? But the question for us as a traditional broadcasters is, so then what's television offering? What does arts traditionally do on television, and how will it need to change? Lots of the stuff that we do is coverage, highly crafted, massively experienced crews doing it. But if that's already out there, what's the offering that we're going to bring to an audience? And I think we're at a really fascinating moment in terms of broadcasting.
I think that's true. Sorry to jump in. I think that, you know, when you look at the amount of concert footage there is on YouTube, and then you look at, you know, the BBC's Glastonbury coverage, you know, there's a difference, but there's also lots of similarities. It's the same subject matter often. You know, what's the difference? Well, you know, one's television and one isn't. And, you know, sometimes one can be on the other and so forth. But, you know, there is a difference still, I think.
There is, and actually the Shakespeare plays that you mentioned, Katrina, what was it, 37 Shakespeare plays filmed well for £250,000?
I'm not sure what the budget was.
I mean, it's extraordinary. They're filming it in a different way with different cameras. But once, you know, had they come to a traditional broadcaster and said, how would you film these going out in the globe, we would have started from a different place. And so so many things are up for grabs at the moment. And there are lots of spaces for people to go into to say, have you thought of doing it like this? And I think, you know, for us who were used to be the gatekeepers, things are changing. And I think questions about, should we be providing what audiences want, or should we be providing stuff that we think is good and we don't know whether audiences are going to come to them? How do we innovate? How can we tell stories in a different way? How can we find talent before they just do it themselves? It's exciting times.
How do you, I mean, obviously lots of people in this room are arts programme makers. I'd love to talk about the commissioning process from your perspective. How long, for example, you have to pitch a project that someone has brought to you that you think is great to your channel controller? How much do their tastes determine what's going to get through? I mean, if you have a channel controller who's not that into ballet, does that mean there are no ballet programmes for 10 years? How does that work? And if you really believe in something, how can you fight for it?
I think it's very...
Katrina, do you want to move up, by the way? I feel like you're a bit isolated.
I'm from Australia. I'm used
right
to
down under there. And that very much includes you as well.
In my case, television commissioning is pretty subjective. And with Channel 4, which is a much smaller institution than the BBC, I think Channel 4 eras are defined by that collection of people who are in the building. And so the subjectivity becomes greater. I think there are strategies, though, and we know what, you know, we know what the arts can do for the channel, which is not just ratings, hardly ever ratings. It's reputation and its profile and its intelligence and its cheekiness.
But for whom, though? Because if your audience doesn't want to watch arts programmes...
Well, when you say our audience, I mean, there are things that we could do that would get huge audiences, that would be mindless, crass, freak showish, that I wouldn't describe as our audience. Mm. I mean, that sounds a bit arrogant, but when you think of... So I said that the Grayson figures for the first episode were about 750,000. He had a massive sellout exhibition at the British Museum, which was extended and incredibly popular. And the total number of people who went through the doors was 118,000. So in one episode, we got 750. So it's not an insignificant number of people who are being exposed to him and his art and his take on the world. But in terms of the commissioning process, it's basically begging and then crying.
It's good to know that you do beg and cry on our behalf, though, because I think sometimes it can feel that, you know... I mean, if people bring you a taster tape, can you guarantee that the controller is even going to watch that tape if it's something that you like?
Well, you can guarantee that they can watch it if you put it on in your routine and switch the machine on, and quite often they're saying, look, can we watch that later, please, sort of thing. So there is a certain amount of that goes on, but, you know, it's particularly frustrating for you know, producers and filmmakers who come to me and say, I've got a brilliant idea, and I go, oh, yeah, that's a really good idea. Let me see where I can get with it. And then, couldn't get anywhere with it. It's really frustrating. And, you know, sometimes you're trying to second-guess the controllers, trying to appeal to their taste. Sometimes, it's a mixture of that and trying to, have a strategy in your head of what the arts should be on the BBC. And sometimes those things, surprisingly enough, when you think that arts, particularly the more challenging arts programmes, tend not to be the highest rating things on a channel, it's not surprising that sometimes there's some interesting dialogue that occurs at the point you pitch it. I mean, I won't deny the fact that there are some things there they kind of go, why would I want that on my channel? And, it's not their channel, and you know what I mean. So there is a bit of that, but at the same time, I think it's what television's about. It's about trying to get your ideas across, and quite often you will find a way of, sort of tweaking the idea that suddenly you get a new, you find sort of a presenter that appeals more, or a way in that works better. Or sometimes you just think, well, actually, maybe it is just, an item on the culture show, or something where where you can be a little bit more autonomous. Or sometimes you just think, that's a great idea, but it should really be on the space.
Do you ever think, that's a great idea, it should be on Channel 4? Here you go, Tabitha, have it. I mean, how much kind of... Jan said a wonderful expression earlier about having the coffee stains of each other's projects. It can get passed backwards and forwards between controllers or commissioners.
We all know it works that way. And, and it's not surprising. If you don't get the right answer, the answer you're looking for from one, then of course you go to the other. I mean, I think there are some things that feel like BBC projects to some extent, some things that feel like Channel 4 projects. And that's healthy. Just like, you can tell what a newspaper stands for by, you just look at the thing and you know the kind of journalism you're going to get from that. That's good. But at the same time, you want to be surprised. It's a mixture. You want the edges to be, you want some things that are on the BBC. You think that could have been on Channel 4 and vice versa.
Yeah, we didn't actually find out. What are you most jealous of?
On a weekly basis, I look at things like, God, that was really good. I really enjoyed the Grace and Perry. It's been turned into a bit of a hymn of praise to Grace and Perry. I thought it was a really interesting, challenging, unusual, original approach to that subject. We made a series about class with Melvin Bragg, previously mentioned. And, maybe if we'd got him in a frock, it would have been a different thing. But,
figure... Instead, you let him in, he went to Sky Arts.
He made it this year, and, conversations are ongoing. He's not exclusive. And we got about a million and a half people watched that. So, the numbers were high because Melvin's a well-known presenter, and he approached it in a more straightforward way. But I couldn't help but feel a twinge of excitement watching, some of the Grayson series. You're slightly kind of, can't believe he did that sort of thing, which I think is an exciting thing to be feeling at times. So I felt jealous of that. There was a Liz Taylor's jewellery collection film, which Michael Waldman made, which I thought was really good a couple of months ago. Actually, a BBC Four film that was that Adam looked after. I felt, that could have been me. The John Cooper Clarke film was brilliant. And Ursula, I see you in the audience. I love that Karen Wu film that you made. But then none of them necessarily straight arts films, all of those. But, there's a lot I like that's not on the BBC necessarily.
Katrina, tell us about your pitching process. I mean, how much of a battle is it to get the sorts of arts programmes you want to see on there made?
Look, it's okay so far. 2 months in, I've got three pretty kooky things across the line and one really kind of obvious slam dunk. I mean, the challenge for us is that, a lot of the arts programme just doesn't rate, so there's just completely different pressures.
We haven't even talked about the fact that budgets are shrinking beyond belief as well.
Absolutely.
I mean, Mark, delivering quality first has just meant delivering smaller budgets as far as many of us can see.
Not entirely. I mean, some of the budgets on BBC Four, a lot of people say they're challenging. Budgets on the space, the people who are making that stuff would jump at the chance of using those kind of budgets. They are challenging, and to some extent you're doing them for, working at those budgets because you really want to make the film. But, we have much bigger budgets. BBC One and Two budgets are significantly higher. I think they're fair. I think they're challenging, but they're not unfair. And we've got a duty to offer value as well as quality.
The budget question has made some hands go up, I see. If we can quickly get a microphone over to the front. These two, this lady in the second row and this gentleman in the first row.
Well, I'm a little bit provocatively asking this whole question about coverage versus really the making of programs. Surely coverage in some cases is a huge strain on the budget. I mean, it must be very hard to justify doing Glastonbury to the extent that you do every year at the expense of other material. In the end, it's commercial artists that you're documenting performances of, and God knows 20 years from now we'll all be glad to have that in the archive, I suppose. But for the immediate, what is it delivering to the community, if you will, or to the TV audience, and at the expense of what?
Well, we've been doing Glastonbury for a while. So we're doing Glastonbury not at the expense of anything. I mean, we have an ongoing relationship with Glastonbury. I think it's... You get a lot of artists in, you know, a few days. There's a huge amount of variety there. The audiences enjoy it, come to the BBC to watch it. You get a lot of coverage across a number of channels from it. I mean, I think it's our duty to do that, to do the proms, to do a lot of performance, to do, you know, particularly in the music area, because that's always been what we've done. You know, the proms has been going for decades, and, you know, I don't think we should, you know, be thinking, oh, you know what, we should be making documentaries instead.
But say yourself that, you know, things turn up on YouTube, and in many ways there's not that much difference, and as smartphones get better and as technology gets better for people to kind of shoot those performances
themselves. I don't think I quite said that. I think the way the proms is filmed doesn't look like a kind of mobile phone job. I think we should embrace the new technology, but... I think that, you know, we should be doing both. We should be doing coverage. We should be making documentaries. We have a duty to make films that are like artworks in themselves as well. I mean, I think there's a huge range of stuff we should be doing. And the BBC, I think, is big enough that it should be continuing to try to do as much of it as possible.
Let's hear from this gentleman.
I'm Adam Barker. I work with Mark Bell and Jan at the BBC. And I'd like to address a slightly different elephant in the room, if that's OK. So when people say we're all on the same side, what the people on the panel mean is we all get regularly battered by our channel controllers about the size of arts audiences. And I think kind of, you know, there's obviously conversations to be had about what different broadcasters are doing. And it's wonderful to have a kind of, a competitive creative economy in arts programmes. That's lovely. But there's also a thing which is kind of about keeping the arts and music on television, and that's terribly important, I think. And in their different ways, you know, the people on this panel are kind of trying to find ways of doing that in a way that both kind of authentically reflects the arts and music and kind of satisfies the television audience. And I think sometimes, I don't want to bang the drum for the BBC, but we slightly take for granted the kind of the level of coverage on the BBC. We take it for granted in the same way that we take BBC News for granted. And it would be nice to feel sometimes, as well as being kind of cross with me or Mark for not having commissioned your programmes, that we have a kind of common cause, which is kind of believing very passionately in these things and wanting them to keep them on our screens.
Well said. Anyone like to come back on that? We've got about 5 minutes left, so now is the time to keep asking your questions if you have any more. Ooh, two here. Let's hear them both and then...
I want to pick up on something that Tabitha said. Does one actually want to make programs the public wants to see, or does one want to make programs oneself is interested in? And I think television has gone very far from bringing to people things that the commissioning editors or the heads of the departments actually want to make, and have gone very far to make things which one believes somebody else wants to see. And in the process, I think you have lost two-thirds of the intelligence audience, which actually does queue up and go to exhibitions and buys expensive catalogues, but doesn't watch arts programmes on television anymore.
Can we just take this other question as well, and then maybe if you want to come back on either
of those. I just want to say something quickly, though. I mean, it's interesting, you know, the kind of audience who go to arts exhibitions. I mean, in Australia, which is a pretty bogan kind of non-arts community relative to Australia, and you know we're up for that. But the reality is that more people go to the museums each year than see the footy. So whilst we're kind of cliched as there's a kind of a divide between the arts audience and the general public, there isn't a divide.
It's also drastically cheaper in many ways to go to the opera than it is to go to see Man United, for example. So this idea that somehow it's much more expensive and it's only for an elite audience is not necessarily...
Yeah, I don't think it's true. I think that the arts audience is the mainstream, but, you know, the challenge is having that balanced slate so that you've got the populist and you've got the kind of the rare and the special and the kind of the jewels that you can discover and you know, thrill your audience with, which something that is a kind of reality format probably isn't going to do.
I'd like to come back on what Ryan just said. I think that the BBC, because of the way it's funded, has a duty to appeal to a broad range of people. I don't think that arts programmes will ever rate as highly as The X Factor or The Voice, nor should they. Nor should they even try, because in trying, you'll probably lose the audience that loves the might love the programme in the first place. So, you know, I buy that aspect of it. But, you know, the fact that we respond to viewers is what television's about. There are a few other mediums that, you know, the fact that I can get, 4 million people watching a programme about a single painting that may or may not be by Monet is, I think, justification for doing it. Because I think those 4 million people, many of them will be people who don't live in the arts world, don't necessarily go to galleries. You know, they may watch the Antiques Roadshow and come to an arts programme.
Is there a cut-off bottom number, though? I mean, if you get...
I don't mind. You know, there are a lot of programmes that I get where I get only 150,000 viewers, and I don't mind. I think we should be doing the space. I think we should be doing a range of things, and I think we have the benefit of a portfolio of channels where we can. And I, you know, I'd stand up and say, you know, tell me, really, truthfully, how much better it was in the old days. You watch some of those programmes, I tell you. You know, they're not all as brilliant as you think they, as you remember them. And some of them are great, but, you know, some of the ones that are being now are great. I read in the paper, I read in the paper that the Telegraph reviewed this Turner programme, which only a couple of 100,000, 290,000 people watched it. I was fine with that because it was up against the football. And it'll get repeated and hopefully get a few more viewers, especially when I proselytise about it like now. And somebody said, we seem to be living, the reviewer said, I think we're living through a golden age of arts documentaries. Well, it's not me saying that, it was him saying that. And I, you know, but I buy it to some extent. There's some really good stuff out there.
I just promised this man we'd have his question too, and it's pretty much all we've got time for. So, have you got a mic there?
Yeah.
Oh.
One question, I think. The person in front of me, not this one.
I think it's this gentleman in the front row, sorry. Thank you.
Thank you. It's quite an easy one, really. I'm a development producer, but I specialise in specialist factual. But this is an area I want to get into simply because I love the arts and the content that all of you are producing. So it'd just be really nice to know from your perspectives, what is the best and most efficient way for development producers outside of your broadcasters to bring first ideas to you?
Find them in the bar later. No. Quickly, should we finish?
The best and most efficient way is via the medium of champagne, but the most professional way is through the online commissioning system.
We have a similar system, but you know, if you can get my attention either by an email or a phone call or something, it's sometimes quite hard because I do get a lot of both of those things. Then you know, that's quite a quick way, and you know, sometimes it is an online conversation which you think, that'd be interesting, but it's about having a, you know, the best way of attracting my attention is having a really good, clear idea, you know.
No pressure.
And conferences and, you know, documentary conferences and places where, you know, we are having these stacks of meetings are really important to meet people and develop that relationship. It's true that if your name's familiar, then your email will be read.
Thank you all so much for being here. Thank you to our wonderful panellists for shedding so much insight into what's driving you all. Many thanks.